you stand with me as we read together our call to worship? I will be your God. Together, I will walk among you and will be your God. One called to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. I will call to mind the deeds of the Lord. I will remember your wonders of old. I will meditate on all your work and muse on your mighty deeds. Your way, O God, is holy. What God is so great as our God? Know therefore that the Lord your God is God, the faithful God who mounts in confidence with those who love him and keep his commandments to a thousand generations. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. Ah, Lord God, it is you who made the heavens and the earth by your great power and by your outstretched arm. Nothing is too hard for you. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. Therefore, we sing.
Psalm 100. Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Know this, The Lord himself is God. He himself has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and call upon his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from age to age.
Good morning, church family. You guys look great. I have an important question for you. Do you all have gasoline? God is good, and he is in control. We're so glad that you're here this morning. If this is your first time with us, we would love for you to fill out a card on the pew rack in front of you. We would love to thank you for your visit and pray for you this week. If you are a church member, feel free to use that to update us on your address or provide an encouraging word. We would love that. I pray that you would be welcomed here, that the words that come out of our mouths would be reflections of our hearts that are devoted to God today. We're so glad that you're here. Welcome.
Let's continue this time of worship. We sing, "There is a name I love to hear. Oh, how I love Jesus."
Ephesians 6:10, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power.
1 Corinthians 16:3, be on your guard and stand firm in faith.
Ephesians 6:11, put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes.
children for leading us in worship this morning. As we continue in worship, we're singing a series of songs based on our love for God. And that's our theme of the day. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, your strength. Would you stand with me as we sing?
Our Father and our God, as we pause in this time of worship this morning to remember people in our congregation who have gone through some difficult days, we recognize that you are a God who loves us, and even in the midst of pain and difficulty, and even life's celebrations, Father, we're reminded that you're always present. We thank you for that today. We remember Chuck Cagle and the death of his aunt. We remember Blair Payne in the death of his father. We remember those that have been in the hospital this week. They're represented by Vicki Willis, Patsy Buckner, Naroma Benz, Doris French and Dan Cochran and Wayne MacDonald. Father, these are family members of our congregation who are in the hospital. And oh God, they need your presence so much today. Some of them are right at the very threshold, Father, of crossing over from this life to the next. Father, if that's the case, we ask that your Holy Spirit would bring comfort to family members as only you can. But God, we also pray for miracles of healing. We know that your arm is not too short to save. Father, we celebrate today with Anna and Jamie Nabokoski and the death of their daughter, the birth of their daughter. God, we celebrate with them and pray that today there would be a special day as family gathers and as they look forward to welcoming this new life into their family. Father, we remember not only our service men and service women and our missionaries, but God, we pause today to remember the people of New York City with the recent bombing that took place there in these last several hours. And Father, that you would continue to watch over people in this nation and protect us from acts of terrorism. And God, help us to be able to fight for the truth and to do so in a way that brings honor to you. I pray that you'll use the offerings that we're about to give, and Lord, that you would bless them as they are converted into food for people who are hungry and gospel medicine for those who need it. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
It's a good day to be in God's house, God's people. If you couldn't see that on the faces of the boys and girls as they sang, then you should have been sitting closer. If you couldn't see it in Emily's fingers as they delicately moved across the harp strings, I wish you could have been sitting a lot closer. And Sanctuary Choir, you bless us every Sunday. Thank you for that beautiful, beautiful anthem. We're talking today about the greatest commandment. How do you put that into words? What is the most important thing? Or what is the best way to do a certain thing? I want you to trade places with me for just a moment. I want you to think about what it would be like to be the pastor of this great, great church. I mean, I can't begin to tell you what a privilege it is. But I want you to step in my shoes for just a moment, and I want you to handle a couple of questions. What is the best way for us to worship? Is it with bagpipes? Is it with a pipe organ? Is it with a banjo? Is it with a steel guitar? Is it like our Church of Christ friends without any instruments of modern technique that aren't mentioned in the Bible? Is it sitting under a broom tree and hearing a drum beat out the rhythm of a hymn? What is the best way for us to worship? Is it with screens or without screens? Is it to have communion every time we gather or only four times a year on those months that end in a wa or whatever? Because however you would attempt to answer that question, you're going to find yourself at odds with someone else who prefers it just a little bit different from the way you've described. I use that as just an illustration because in some ways it's about what Jesus found himself in Matthew chapter 22. The Sadducees are asking him questions, Pharisees are asking him questions, and every time they're asking him questions, what they're really looking for is not the answer. They're really looking for the opportunity of putting Jesus at odds with somebody else in the conversation. We know that in the case in point in our text this morning because it tells us that an expert in the law, someone who knew the Old Testament law very, very well, who knew that there were 613 laws alone in the first five books of Moses that all of God's people were expected to keep. And he comes to Jesus and he says, in an effort to trap him, to test him, to put Jesus at odds with somebody else in the room, they raise the question, what is the greatest commandment? What is the greatest of all these laws? If Jesus were to begin to quote one of the laws as opposed to one of the other laws, then there is no question about this. He would have put himself at odds with someone else who was interested in the answer in that conversation. And in a way that we have grown to anticipate, Jesus answers this question. He says in verse 37, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment." Now, when Jesus says this to this particular expert in the law, Jesus is answering the question once and for all. And he does so by quoting this Old Testament passage that our Jewish friends would have known because they would have entrusted this to memory. They would have put their hand on the doorpost every time they go in or out of their home, and they would have recited, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is one. And you shall worship the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength or might." Jesus takes this and he changes that last word, uses the word mind instead of strength. And some have suggested that maybe it was an all-inclusive way of saying Jesus perhaps speaking to an audience that would have understood something more with their mind than perhaps with their strength as they might have in a previous generation. I don't know that that's the case at all. Somebody else has suggested that Jesus uses the word mind because he wants us to be people who think, and think not only logically, but critically. And so with logic and criticism, appropriate kinds of criticism, we approach this great Old Testament law, and Jesus elevates it and says, the most important thing, the greatest thing you can do is to love the Lord your God with all you have. Everything you're about. How do we do that? I want to encourage us today to love God more. Okay, well, Pastor, how do we love God more than we already do? You could look at any number of sources on this. If you were to Google, how do I love God more? It's going to take you to some great websites, some good information's out there. It's on the internet. It's available. Ever since Al Gore invented the information highway, our spiritual life has benefited, has it not? You can find a list that says things like, well, if you're going to love God, you need to know God. Because to know God is to love God. And you need to worship God. And not only do you need to worship God, you need to find a way to read His Word and obey His Word. Because if you really love God, then you're going to be obedient to everything that He said to do. It's one of the ways that we demonstrate our love for God. All that's true. I want to get a little bit deeper into this, and I hope this will feel deeper to some of you. Please don't raise your hand to this next question to answer it. But how many of you have ever been in love before and then have found yourself one day not so much in love as you once were? See, I told you not to raise your hand. If you ever felt like love has grown cold, if you ever felt like something changed and because of the changes that life is throwing your way, that you just, maybe you've fallen out of love. You ever used words like that? If I were having a pastoral conversation with you, I can tell you exactly what I'd say. This is about the greatest pastoral counsel I can share with you on a topic like that. That if you say you love someone and you find yourself feeling somehow out of love or the love has grown cold and you're wanting to do something about it, then the counsel is simple. You make a list of the things that you would do for that person if you did love them. And then you do those things. Breakfast in bed. Flowers. Cards. Phone calls. Date night. There are a number of ways you're going to fill in that list, but you make a list of the things that you would do if you really loved that person, and then you simply do those things. When it comes to our relationship with God, you ever felt like there was a time in your life that you were closer to God than you are right now? Have you ever felt that maybe at some point in your spiritual journey, things were hotter in your relationship with Him. The Holy Spirit may have had more of you, and it seemed like when you bent your knee to pray that God was listening, and that when God listened, God also answered. And did it seem like when you read your Bible, it stirred your heart more, and it convinced you of truth, and it helped you make decisions? Did you ever feel that way once? But yet, for some reason, today, those fires have grown cold. Some would say, well, the way to handle that is to make a list of the things that you would do if you really loved God. Well, what would be on your list? Oh, here we go. I'll help you with it. Well, I'll get up early, and I'll have my quiet time. I'll honor my commitment to read God's Word and to pray daily, and I know how important it is, and I'm going to do that before I do anything else. I'm going to go to church. I'm going to be in church because the Scripture says, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together, as some do. And so I'm gonna make the commitment to be there. I'm going to be involved, and I'm going to also allow my hands and my feet to be the hands and the feet of Christ. I'm going to serve people, and I'm going to do so for the cause of Christ. I'm not going to do this for personal recognition. I'm not going to do this for attention. I don't care who gets the credit for it. I'm going to roll my sleeves up. I'm going to volunteer. I'm going to serve others for the sake of the gospel. I'm going to share what Christ has done in my life. I'm going to find someone who will be receptive and open to hearing perhaps how I've seen God at work. And I'm going to find an opportunity. I'm going to create ways to creatively share my faith with others. Well, if I could do those things, if I could make a list and do some of those things and do them well, oh, that's not an exclusive list, is it? Some of you are saying, well, I would tithe if I really loved God. I would teach Sunday school, third grade boys, if I really loved God. I'd join the choir. I heard some amens. If you really loved God, you'd make this list and you'd say, I'm going to do it. And I look at the Scripture in this particular passage, and I know that Jesus was being put in a position where it was a trap, it was a test. But I'm also reminded that sometimes I put Him to the test as well, don't you? God, I really love You, but I want to watch this on television. Or God, I really love You, but when I'm out daydreaming on the internet, then my mind kind of takes me to some places, and God, You understand that, don't You? Or God, in my conversations that I have with people in my small group, my Bible study, my Sunday school class, it's the meetings in the hallways, God, it really doesn't matter if I say things that run somebody else down, does it? And see, we begin to put God to the test in a number of ways. We try to trap Jesus to say that what we do is really somehow okay, even though we know that it tears at the heart of the gospel. Now, if the church loves God, then the church is going to recognize that when we have our conversations with one another, that it's just like talking to God in prayer. And that our activities online and offline and in the dark when nobody's around have to be just as holy and just as pure as if we were praying. And that attendance on Sundays isn't just in case there's nothing else to do or no better offer, but that it really does matter that we gather together not only for the sake of the gospel, but because of what Christian fellowship is, that you bring things into this room that will rub off on the shoulders of somebody else who's going to need them at just the right time. You'll say the right words. Your smiling face will encourage and make a difference. When somebody says, "Does anybody else have something to say?" you'll stand up and you'll say something to encourage the body of Christ. That's how we love God. Last week I spoke about loving your neighbor, which is the second part of this. Jesus says to this individual expert in all of these matters of the Old Testament law, he says, and you know the second one is, it's very similar, it resembles it, it's like the first, that you'll love your neighbor as yourself. From those words, we as a congregation years ago came to a decision that when somebody were to ask us, what is our purpose, what's our motto, what's our driving statement as a congregation, that it's to love God and love people. Jesus said that everything in the Old Testament law, including the Ten Commandments, hung on the balance of our ability to love God and to love people. It's that simple. Are there some benefits for loving God? You better believe there are. Do you remember the woman who came in and kind of crashed the dinner party when Jesus was at Simon's house? And there he was, and this woman had the audacity to demonstrate her love for Jesus by anointing him with oil and by weeping and washing his feet with her tears and letting down her hair and drying. Do you remember what Jesus had to say about her? He said, because she has loved much, her sins, which were many, are forgiven. Boy, for no other reason, and if nobody else but me were to say this, I want to love God more because my sins, which are many, need forgiveness. What about protection? Those who love God are under the shadow of his wing. What about purpose? Doesn't the scripture say that all things work together for the good of those who love God and who are called according to his purpose? M. Scott Peck years ago wrote this book that's on many of your shelves, The Road Less Traveled. It's worth the price of the book just to read the very first sentence in that book. You know what it says? Life is difficult. Can I get a witness? And doesn't it feel somehow like the difficulties in life that I go through make sense because there is a God of purpose who is working behind the scenes so that things will work out according to his plan? I don't always understand why bad things happen to good people. I don't understand why good things happen to anybody sometimes, let alone the bad things. But there's something comforting about knowing that there is a God of order and a God of purpose who, even behind the scenes when I don't understand, has my best interest at heart. Well, I want to love God because I need somebody like that in my corner. How about you? I want to find ways, and I'm willing to say this, I want to find whatever it takes to keep the love relationship that I have with God burning brightly. This is a vital connection for each one of us. What is the greatest commandment? What is the greatest priority? What is the greatest purpose? What is the greatest one thing for you and for me? Remember what Paul said? He was writing to Timothy. And it's right there where he's getting to the personal closing words to Timothy, and he says to him, do your best to come before winter. Timothy is where? Paul is where? He's in prison. If you're in prison, the only way you're going to be cared for is for people on the outside who care for you to come and see you. And so before the winter storms sweep in and before the way becomes inaccessible, Paul urges Timothy, please do everything you can to come see me. Why? Because, and then he goes through this list and he says, Demas has deserted me because he loved this world too much. We don't know exactly what Demas was doing. I don't know exactly what his attraction was. I don't know what the allure was that pulled at Demas's heart and moved him from a disciple, a follower, one who was with Paul at one time sending greetings, one who was with Dr. Luke and Paul encouraging him. But now we see at this later stage in Paul's life, he says, Demas, because he has loved this world too much, has deserted me. Here's what I know. I know that it's really, really easy to be captured by the world's allure. I know that it's easy to put myself in a place where the enemy knows exactly what my weak points are and what my buttons are that he can push. And he knows where the temptations are that I find almost irresistible. And I know without a doubt that I could be a Demas one day very easily. And so could you. There are too many things that can draw us away. And one day somebody will say, well, he left because he loved the world too much. No, you and I want to be, we want to be lovers of God, don't we? We want the fires to be hot. And so because of that, I don't know what the distraction is. A lot of times we settle for good things in the place of the better things and the best things. And a lot of times the distractions in life will keep us so far removed from those priorities, those spiritual disciplines that are designed to help us stay in a loving relationship with God and a growing relationship with God and a posture with God that allows His Holy Spirit to continue to bring the image of Christ ever more evident in our life. Is television going to do that? No. Is the internet going to do that? No. Are the friends on the outside? No, they're not going to do it. What's going to do it? It's a love relationship. It's putting God first. Jesus answers this question to someone trying to trap him, test him. But you and I today might just as easily say, God, if there's one thing in my life that I need to do a better job of doing, God, what is it? It's loving Him. And when you're loving God and you're in His presence, you begin to recognize something amazing, and that is that God loves us more than we could ever imagine. That's what the gospel is. That there's nothing that we can do to make God love us any less. That we're bad enough as sinners, whether we want to admit it or not, that we're guilty and we were in need of a Savior, and that God loved us so much that He gave His Son Christ to die for us. And he loves us today more than we can ever imagine. I want to invite you to bow your head for just a moment. We're going to move to our time of invitation, and this morning it might be that you're here this day needing a place to call your church home. How you can claim to love God and not love His church is a mystery to me. I don't see how you can do that. If you don't have a place that you call your church home, then today I would invite you to let us welcome you into this place. A place where other believers will encourage you and encourage your growth and pray with you, and a place where your gifts can be used to encourage the body of Christ. Today, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, there's not a more important decision that you can make today than to decide which side of the cross you're going to be on. You've heard facts about Christ, and you've heard me preach, you've heard other preachers preach, and today, for the first time perhaps in your life, you're willing to say, "Dear God, I'm asking Jesus Christ to forgive me of my sin and to come into my heart, and God, I surrender my life to the Lordship of Christ." Father, as heads are bowed and hearts are humbled before you, then in these moments I pray that your Holy Spirit accomplishes the work you desire in each one of our hearts and lives. Oh God, move us closer into a fervent, urgent love relationship with you. And God, please don't let us be satisfied with anything but that. In Christ's name, amen. We're going to sing an invitation hymn, and I invite you to come this morning. I'll be standing down front. One or two of our other ministers will join me. If we can pray with you, we'd consider that a privilege. Let's stand, let's sing, and you come. Thank you, church. Would you please be seated for just a moment? Church, we are so thrilled and so honored today to be able to have this privilege of dedicating twin boys that were born in the Gregory household just a few weeks ago. And so standing with me today is the entire Gregory family. This is Adrian. And it seems like yesterday I was dedicating Adrian here at this altar. And this is his sister Lucia, who is crawling up the steps, and she's going to be fine. We're not going to worry about her at all. It's perfectly good. Joe, you could sit with her, I bet. Perfect. Perfect. And this is Adrian and Lucia's mother and father, Justin and Kat Gregory. And they are holding in their arms these precious little boys who were born recently. James Andrew. Which one is James Andrew? This is Drew. James Andrew. The name James means nurtured, and the name Andrew means courageous. And the life verse that Justin and Kat have selected for Drew comes from James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. Consider it a great joy, my brothers, whenever you experience various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. But endurance must do its complete work so that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing. And then Daniel William. And Kat is holding little Daniel. The name Daniel means discerning, and the name William means protector. And the life verse that has been chosen for Daniel comes from the book of Daniel, chapter 6, verses 26 and 27. For he is the living God, and he endures forever. His kingdom will never be destroyed, and his dominion has no end. He rescues and delivers. He performs signs and wonders in the heavens and on the earth. For he has rescued Daniel from the power of the lions. Well, Justin and Kat, as you stand here holding your new sons, surrounded by your family and those who love and care for you, I ask you the same questions that I've asked you before, and questions that I've asked other families as well. Do you promise to do everything that you can as the Lord leads to incline your sons so that one day they can express their faith in Christ Jesus, having seen Christ in you through family devotions and prayers and your example and your faithfulness to his church? Will you do everything you can so that these boys can know Christ as their Savior? And if so, will you say, we will?
We will.
Church family, we have been praying for these twin boys for these last several weeks on Sunday mornings. And it's a miracle that they're here this day. Church, if you want the Gregories to know that you will pray for them as parents and that you will do everything you can as the Lord calls you to be Sunday school teachers and to work in vacation Bible school and children's choir programs and mission programs, that you'll do everything within your power to help them raise their children to know Christ as their Savior. Would you let them know that by saying amen?
Amen.
Today, we're not touching these boys because they're still pretty vulnerable. But I'm going to ask Justin and Kat and Adrian and Lucia if they'd like to just to follow me as we walk into kind of the very center of this room for just a moment. And in doing so, we somehow symbolically see ourselves surrounded by this great church family and this cloud of witnesses. And we're thankful for what God is doing. We're thankful that he's a miracle-working God, that he was with you in the experiences that brought these boys into this world, and that he continues to be with you this day. And we look forward to the day that in their own strength, they come into this auditorium and perhaps stand on those steps and sing with choirs or sit there for children's features. But we really look forward to the day that they will respond to Christ's call to lordship and come down the aisle of their church and profess their faith in Christ. Church family, I'll invite you to pray with me this morning. Our Father, for your goodness today, we pause to just recognize it and to say thank you. God, for your saving power that brought these two boys, Daniel and Drew, into this world and has given them life and breath and strength. And God, for godly parents who love you and put you first and demonstrate that as they raise their children. We pray for them. God, we pray for this church family as we welcome these boys into our circles. God, may they be given strength every day. May they be wise, and may they be strong, and may they be pure. In Jesus' name, amen. Jeff, would you stand with me, please? It's a joy this morning to introduce Jeff Kirian. Did I say that right?
Yes.
Good. Jeff Kirian comes this morning saying that he knows Christ as his Savior and his Lord, and he needs a church home and believes that God wants him to be right here. And church, I know you're excited about that, and you're going to let Jeff know this morning of your prayer support and your encouragement to him and the commitment and the decision that he's made. And if you'd like Jeff to know of your prayer support today, would you simply say amen?
Amen.
Jeff, that's lots of folks.
Yes, sir.
And today when our service is over, I want to invite you to come and to greet Jeff personally. Tell him that you're thankful for the decision that he's made. Jeff, there's some friends that are coming and standing around you today. We do this in our church when somebody wants to come and make First Baptist their home. We come and stand around and let them know that we're glad that they're here. And so I'm honored to be your pastor, so thankful to have you here today. And we look forward to what God is going to do in your life. Well, church, it's been good to be in God's house this morning. We're going to continue in a spirit of worship, and I encourage you today to demonstrate the love of God in your life to someone who needs it. And Joe's going to dismiss us in song. Let's stand together, and I look forward to seeing you in the foyer if you're a guest today.